the woman he loved for all those years was God. The reason for his leaving was God. It was never the same.
Horror bears many labels.
And think of that repeated millions of times.
Communism, fascism, socialism.
There was no hope. There was darkness.
New world order.
People did not talk. People did not smile.
None different.
They had no reason to. There was no food. Everything was rationed. But the elites had everything. They had special stores. They had special services. They were living in other people's homes with no remorse.
The Department of Homeland Security issued a declaration to all law enforcement, state, local, and federal, saying that the future threats to America were right-wing Christian groups, Second Amendment groups, pro-life groups, and returning veterans.
Wake up, America, while you still have time. Slumber is over.
The young men and women that are serving our nation today, that are coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan and other places in the world, and they are declared to be future threats to America.
I see these things happen here in America.
Well, what was that all about? Well, in my view, fitting the model, it was about suppressing the opposition.
Your children and grandchildren will cry at your graves if you do nothing.
It was about discrediting the opposition, because I fall into all four categories.
Do something.
The next thing that you'll see in the Marxist model is you will see an effort to censor. You can't have an open press. Well, in our country, the mainstream media is really not a problem as we look at this model, because fundamentally most of them are left anyhow. Most of them are progressives or liberals.
We no longer have freedom of religion.
What you do have to censor is you have to censor pastors.
There is freedom from religion. God has disappeared from your school, from Easter, from Christmas. There are winter holidays and spring holidays.
Pastors have a ready audience. Pastors have an opportunity to stand up and speak against these kinds of things, to talk about the evils of Marxism, socialism.
You do have to have a spiritual life if you want to keep your family and society together.
The fact is that the legislation that was passed, that we now know as hate crimes legislation, was designed to make it more difficult for pastors to stand up and talk about moral and social issues in America.
I'm very familiar with that.
The next thing that you'll see in the Marxist model is you will see an effort to control gun ownership.
By decree, people were forced to turn in their weapons.
Because you can't have a population that is armed. Now, if you look at the fact that our president and our secretary of state have both said that our president, our administration, will sign the United Nations Small Arms Declaration, it must cause concern among Americans who believe in the Second Amendment rights to buy and own weapons. And those who support this legislation or support this whole concept of a UN Small Arms Declaration will tell you that it is designed primarily to focus on military weapons. Well, the question we have to ask ourselves as Americans, do you trust that?
I'm Larry Pratt, Executive Director of Gun Owners of America. We lobby the Congress from Springfield, Virginia, which is right outside the Beltway in the suburbs of the District of Columbia. We have been doing this for over three decades, and we approach lobbying rather differently from many other organizations in town. Our emphasis begins with a realization that there's a bunch of socialists that are at war with the freedoms of America and with the property of America, the children of America. They want it all. And of course they want our guns. and we react accordingly. Namely, you can't work within the system, and even our friends at the NRA are often working with that view in mind, and we find that you just can't make peace with people who are declaring and conducting total war against you. So we have approached the whole system as one that's broken, one that needs to be changed.
We're accused all the time of being the reason that the Mexican gangs and the cartels have weapons, when in fact that's not true. But does anybody really trust a United Nations international body to determine how we as Americans, under the Second Amendment, buy, sell, and control our arms? Well, I don't.
Our job will be to keep the heat on the new Congress and to push that Republican establishment further and further toward the Constitution, so that they understand that we didn't just want them to stop Obama from doing what he's doing. We don't want them just to roll back what Obama's done, but we want them to get behind measures that, for instance, Representative Paul Brown of Georgia is likely to introduce a repeal of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. That's the kind of thing that's needed. We need to roll back the bad things that we've gotten used to and have been on the books for a long time.
And then the final thing that you see in these Marxist movements is you see the leadership establishes a constabulary force, a force that is designed to control the population.
It's hard for most people to imagine that there is a network of intelligence gathering established in the United States that is gathering information on citizens, criminal and non-criminal. Explaining fusion centers to people who have never heard of them before is not an easy thing to do. The model of a fusion center was developed on the battlefield for military purposes. The battlefield appears to be the United States, where those military tactics, technology, and skills are actually being laid out with a network through the fusion centers, the militarization of the police force. The battlefield now is within the United States. Who are the potential insurgents? Apparently, it's everyday citizens who have to be watched and monitored.
Under communism, people forgot to smile. They could not see a lot of love songs unless they were approved by the government. They could sing praises to the dictator.
We all remember that Hitler had the brown shoes. And of course, in the Night of the Long Knives, Hitler killed a lot of those people because even Hitler became afraid of their power and their control of the population. Well, you say we don't have a constabulary force here. Well, there was a speech that was given in the 2008 election in which our current president said, if I'm elected, I will have a national civilian security force that will be as large as and as well equipped as the U.S. military.
We've got to have a civilian national security force that's just as powerful, just as strong.
You need to read the health care legislation. And you'll discover in there that, in fact, there are provisions for the commissioning of officers to work directly for the president in the time of national emergency. Well, what is a national emergency? And what exactly is the function and the purpose of those officers that would be commissioned to work directly for the president?
I see the history repeating. The history of terror.
So, I think that we need to look realistically and understand that whether we recognize it or not as Americans, our society is moving towards Marxism.
If America changes into a socialist nation, where people like us will go, they will be lost.
America, I warned you, when government, liberal as in remains, shall be drawn to Washington as the center of all power.
It is a fatal tendency to put into place of the delegated will of the nation, the will of a party.
It will render powerless The checks provided of one on another, and will become as venal and oppressive as those from which we separate.
A small but artful and enterprising minority, they are likely in the course of time and things to become potent engines by which cunning, ambitious, and unprincipled men will be enabled to subvert the power of the people and to usurp for themselves the reins of government, afterwards destroying the very engines that raised them to unjust dominion. Let it not be so.
It was a beautiful spring morning in 1944. I was 7 years old and soundly asleep in the early morning when my mother woke me and told me to get dressed. We were going to church. It was a weekday, but the Methodist church in Valdosta, Georgia was packed to the rafters with people come to pray. It was June 6th, D-Day. And as we gathered, the cream of American youth were charging heavily toward by machine guns and artillery fire on the beaches of Normandy, and then shredded to ribbons as they left their amphibious craft and ran onto the beach. It was a slaughter. The casualties were unthinkable, but still they came, wave after wave, taking the beach, one bloody inch at a time. And at the end of the longest day, we were snatched to each other. We lost this one. It was all over for Europe. And where did the people of America turn to for help on that day in 1944? They turned to God. And he answered, like he done so many times before. I just remember a different country. There's a broken heart for every cross and every star daily in the military graveyard in Normandy. Each and every one bearing new witness to a son, father, or husband who gave their life so that America could be a free nation. Are we going to sit on our hands and live our comfortable lives and dishonor the blood spilled at Normandy, Valley Forge, Gettysburg, Shiloh, the frozen mountains of Korea, the jungles of Vietnam, and the deserts of Afghanistan and Iraq? Are we going to passively sit back and allow the future of our children to be put into the hands of NF power drunks, spin crazy politicians, and the evil men hide in the shadows of their dark ivory towers and bullet strings? The answer is no, 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 not now, not ever. I'm not giving up without a fight, and I'm in a fight to finish. I'm not going to stand by and let these scumbags steal my country. But the sad truth is, if mankind tries to do this on our own, we will fail miserably. But we don't have to do it by ourselves. Listen, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins, and will heal their land. 2 Chronicles 7:14, the Holy Bible.
America is in peril.
What is the goal? It is to create a one world government. It's as old as time itself.
The globalist regime has begun the undertaking of transformation. What is America? We're going to feel more of this global dynamic that is changing the nature and scope of the American experience. This plan is called Agenda 21, the agenda for the 21st century.
Agenda 21 is a program to restructure the world.
Human beings inhale oxygen, we exhale CO2. For the first time in human history, governments are going to try to regulate, tax, and put quotas on what we exhale from our mouth. If the United Nations and Obama's EPA has their way, Americans will be forced to emit the same carbon emission volume as they did in 1867.
Kind of like the Trojan horse. You roll it inside the gates, all the bad guys slither out in the dark at night.
The people of the world are waiting for Americans to wake up. Because if we don't wake up, they don't have a chance.
You know what just kills me is how the first thing out of their mouth is always conspiracy theory. Sure, one and one is still two. That's just about the size of it on all this. And conspiracy lives in the District of Columbia.
The only way this is going to be defeated is to understand the nature of what has enveloped our country.
This course has got to change American sovereignty and mankind are going to survive. Question is, who are they? Who are such men? They're slippery, but they're also smart. Dr. Stan Monteith has written about them as the Brotherhood Darkness.
It came out of a meeting that was held on the yacht of Prince Charles of Britannia.
We cannot be anything less than courageous and revolutionary in our approach to tackling climate change.
Prince Charles got in financial leaders and very wealthy people from across the world to actually lay out a program that would be the agenda for the 21st century.
Former French President Jacques Chirac said that the United Nations Global Warming Treaty was the first step to an authentic global governance. Al Gore, in the summer of 2009, said the U.S. Congressional Climate Bill was a key component to establishing global governance. What do they mean by global governance? This is what a German climate advisor waxed about, was called a CO2 budget for every man, woman, and child on the planet. Now, what does that mean? It means you're going to have an international body monitoring your car mileage, your home energy use, your airline travel, your train travel. If you exceed your carbon allowance, you are going to owe an international body not only an explanation, but probably money and a piece of your freedom. I'm Mark Morano, executive editor of ClimateDepot.com. Former staff of the Environment and Public Works Committee in the United States Senate under Senator James Inhofe. I also was a reporter for Rush Limbaugh, the television show.
The cock has crowed, friends. Denial will not stand. And sadly, I'm compelled to paint a sinister story of America adrift. Stand witness to this long-planned agenda for recreating our beloved republic and the world into a tyrannical new world order.
Our economic system is to change from free enterprise into a system of public-private partnerships.
Public. Public refers to government. Local, county, state, federal, the United Nations.
What Benito Mussolini called corporatism and what the world came to know as fascism.
Private refers to non-governmental organizations, corporations, foundations.
So today we see the world changing. Multinational corporations working with governments to pursue this global world government dynamic.
Public-private partnership is basically a masterful, sophisticated, and diabolical way of transferring wealth.
The underlying premise of this Agenda 21 program, often called sustainable development, is the idea that private property to be abolished.
What we are seeing through sustainable development is that property rights, which was the sacred cornerstone of our freedoms, is now out the window.
The rural citizens of this United States have been so outraged over the last 15 years as the federal government has begun to clamp down.
Today there are half the number of ranchers in America as there were just 20 years ago. This is all through the effects of the Agenda 21 policies at the federal level and now at every state level, and in fact now infused into every county in America.
This is one of the most well-financed, organized scare campaigns in the history of the world.
Every county has its Agenda 21 program, and you say, well, how could that be? And the answer is that federal incentives,
the U.S. government alone has spent almost $79 billion.
Political party operatives of both parties, Democrats and Republicans, have as their cornerstone the step-by-step implementation of the Agenda 21 program.
Remember that Agenda 21 is designed to control every single human activity of every single human being on planet Earth.
If you go to the airport, you can have the joy of experiencing a full-body scanner where the government, an agent of the government, can see you or your mother or your father or your youngster naked.
It's going to continue and get worse.
My daughter went through one before we realized what was going on. It is not just checking for metals or explosives. It is actually a full body x-ray that sees every bit of you, including all of your parts, naked. Now, a government that would consider that okay to do is one that has moved into the realm of treating people as slaves or chattel or just an asset or a resource. You're no longer a human who has rights given to you by God, and that there are certain barriers they must not cross. Take the pat down when you go to the airport. You'll at least know, you can look them in the eye to see who's molesting you. We're being experimented on at the airport, in essence. This kind of intrusion into the basic to who you are as a person is an anathema to this country. We were not founded on this. We were founded on each of us is made in God's image, and we have individual rights.
Ever read the Communist Manifesto? It's the UN in a nutshell, and they're driving us to the front door. Its 10 points sound awfully familiar to life in our world, but it ain't supposed to be our world. This is America.
George Bush Sr. went to Rio de Janeiro to an Earth Summit, a United Nations conference.
We should have kicked them rascals out from day one.
And infused every federal department with the protocol of Agenda 21.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, we will be. We have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the U.S. founders.
Much of it's already taken place in a town near you.
Now imagine as America continues its fall, transforming the political economics of this country into a world system where all countries are of equal value. In fact, countries and boundaries are to be extinguished.
We have lost sight of our spiritual heritage. They are coming for your freedom. That spiritual foundation is found in our Declaration of Independence. In the second sentence, declares, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they're endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
We continue to divorce ourselves from the principles that caused America to be the greatest political experiment in the history of the world.
We hear that sentence today, and it seems unremarkable to the average American. We've heard it before. It doesn't make much difference to us. Very few people realize that it is the single most radical statement in Western political history.
Unfortunately, these people want to dramatically limit the population of the world.
In fact, Agenda 21, in its documentation, calls for an 85% reduction in human population.
Even Hollywood couldn't make up stuff like this.
The average American will react with nonchalance with a statement like that because it's too incredible to seem true. But in fact, it is the case.
Well, in the Revelation 6:8, why, of course, the scripture says that I look and behold a pale horse and a rider upon him is death, and Hades followed close behind. And power was given him to kill a quarter of the population of the earth with the sword and with famine and with pestilence and with death. And basically, of course, this whole section of the Bible talks about the four horsemen of the apocalypse. I believe we're seeing that at the present time.
Agenda 21's program for global citizenship is something that is taught in schools today, in schools all over and across America. This is very disturbing that youth are being prepared to live, should they be one of the survivors of this population meltdown, to live in a society where they become drones to a ruling elite, because of course, that's what's behind this whole system.
The truth of the matter is, the premise for Agenda 21 is a lie. It is evil, it is diabolical.
So as we begin to look around the world today, and we begin to think about how it is that they may reduce population, all kinds of potentials begin to arise.
Whether they're gonna resort to war, whether they're gonna resort to pestilence, to disease, and to famine, I don't know, but I suspect that they will. I think this is all being carefully planned.
That's the goal of globalism, is to make every nation interdependent so that no nation can stand alone, all subject to the new order. It is to put us into packed areas where we can be monitored and controlled.
Well, they want to get you out of your car. They want to get people to stop using private transportation and to use public transportation. They want to change the structure of homes. They want to get people out of their homes and into so-called sustainable communities, whether it be in condominiums, small apartments, where they can be watched and monitored all of the time.
Reporting suspicious activity to the authorities is very reminiscent of reading historically about the East German Stasi.
Did you know Homeland Security hired a guy named Marcus Wolf? He's just the ex-head of the East German secret police, along with some of his KGB buddies. Needed some help designing the game plan. By the way, don't forget, they put out a report that vets, that's what I said, veterans, were potential terrorists. Now, why does America need that? It makes your head pop, don't it? My daddy'd roll over in his grave.
Snitches, it would intentionally be in small groups of people in your neighborhood, at the grocery store, wherever you were acting, and somebody would be reporting your activities.
You figure it out, folks. Seems to be we've been had.
If you see something, say something.
It's a public service announcement. It's an attempt to induce a permanent state of fear and paranoia. Why, you ask? So you'll be frightened enough to hand over to the government willingly the few civil liberties you have left.
This is not a society that America should be living in. Most people in our society are supposed to be free, sovereign individuals who are presumed innocent until proven guilty.
To the extent that we do become, in a sense, a police state, where every individual, every citizen is a policeman of some sort, reporting on their neighbors, snitching on what they're doing, looking at what they're doing. I'm sorry, that is not the constitutional republic our founders intended.
Suspicious activity reporting turns everybody into a suspect in anticipation of a future crime.
Technology and advancement of technological resources has grown to such a level that things like RFID chips can be implanted in human beings themselves, or can be planted on your driver's license.
Government surveillance is a liberty killer. In an unchecked surveillance society, we live and behave as prisoners.
You see, the world is moving to the situation where an all-powerful government will have all knowledge about you.
This consortium of global corporations was meeting down the street from Harvard, where at the time I was a graduate student. They were meeting at MIT, and they had already attracted funding from some of the biggest corporations on the globe. I'm talking about companies like Walmart, Procter & Gamble, Gillette, Texas Instruments, Hewlett-Packard, Home Depot, Kimberly-Clark, Nestle, Kraft, you name it, every major corporation you can think of. How would I put this in a genteel way? I got myself into a few of their meetings. I guess I crashed them. And I sat as a fly on the wall, and I listened as some of these corporate executives discussed their plans for using remotely readable microchips to track and monitor people.
Now everybody's part of an information network in a growing surveillance society that is being enabled through the use of technology. Most of us have seen the increase of cameras at stop signs and stop lights.
In London today, the average citizen is photographed 300 times per day.
Personal communication between you and someone else are no longer private. This is a hard concept, particularly for young people who grew up with this technology being right at their fingertips, to understand that every text message and every communication on Facebook and Twitter paint a picture of all of your network of friends. This is examined by analysts in the fusion centers.
We are being monitored. We are being watched.
Property rights, basis of a free society. The UN Agenda 21 is sucking up American territory like a water spout.
The Wildlands Project is designed to take over 50% of the United States and put it off limits to human beings. If you live in the wildlands, you will be moved out.
Believe it or not, 50% of the American landscape into wilderness areas. When the Senate saw what this treaty was really, truly designed to do, it was taken off of the agenda 1 hour before the ratification vote was scheduled to be taken.
The reality about the pursuit of Agenda 21 is fail once, come back later, change your tune a little bit, change the dynamic a little bit.
Gaia, the living planet, what in the world is Gaia? Gaia is the Earth, the mother goddess Earth.
Hazy disguised green protocol and international treaties are the bald-faced lie of need to protect Mother Earth.
This agenda, this philosophy that the Earth is a living organism and trampling over Mother Earth, that we are now the bad guys.
Sustainable development sounds good, don't it? Who wouldn't be for that?
Well, when you look at Agenda 21, when you look at this whole premise of Gaia, The truth of the matter is, it is an inversion and a perversion of Genesis 1. God created heaven and earth. He said it was good. He told man to procreate. He said it would be good.
Most people have little knowledge that tens of thousands of acres are now plushed in wetlands and various conservancies are in fact controlled by the United Nations. Even Yellowstone, think about that, the jewel of American parks. It's like boiling a lobster that he ain't noticed till it's too late. Eminent domain rules. A man's property is his own only as it suits government.
Wildlands Project also intends to prohibit any resource extraction from this landmass. So all of America's resources have been tied up.
Is this right?
Tied up under this globalist dynamic.
In the land of the free and the home of the brave.
The fattest target that we have is to come to understand and recognize an organization that has infiltrated American cities in every state. That organization is called ICLEI. ICLEI stands for the International Council for Local Environmental Initiatives.
It basically commits every single person in the county or the city or whatever jurisdiction it might be to a plan that upholds the principles of Agenda 21
in violation, clearly in my mind, of the U.S. Constitution
and confines our ability to make decisions for ourselves to those made by the United Nations.
Over 600 cities, including Bloomberg-led New York City, have contracts with this internationalist organization.
The whole idea of Agenda 21, of the agenda for the 21st century, is to create a world feudal society.
If you are a baby, and if you are an elderly person, I'm so sorry.
You will certainly have a powerful military and police to keep the people subjugated.
You do not produce. That means you do not have a space on planet Earth.
It is a treasonous act for your mayor and for your city council to sign contracts inflicting your community with the ICLEI program, and it must be exposed. We must begin that process by kicking out ICLEI.
Biometric means measurement of the body. As a technology, it's used to measure physical and behavioral aspects of a person and then transform that personal data into digital code for identification purposes. With biometrics, your body is your ID.
666, mark of the beast, end time prophecy, or just today's reality? Only God knows the time and place, but it don't look good. That is unless you're a Christian. If you read the book, you know how it ends. We win.
IBM, for example, has patented something called the Person Tracking Unit. I mean, you want to talk conspiracy theory, I can't think of a worse name, but that's the name that they actually gave this device when they patented it. And what the Person Tracking Unit is it's an RFID reader, a small little device, that IBM recommends installing into things like doors, walls, floors, ceiling tiles, shelving, in public spaces, so that they can use it to track people.
Biometrics for identification literally places our religious freedoms, our right to privacy, our sovereignty, and our ability to buy and sell into the hands of international organizations.
They want to put them in airports, train stops, bus stops, train stations, into museums, theaters, libraries, sports arenas, shopping malls, even elevators and public.
For many Christians, biometric ID is enrollment into a Mark of the Beast-like system.
The chilling part was it said every human being,
the entire world is being enrolled into a single global biometric system of identification and financial control.
The kind of environment where authoritarian officials with jackboots could say, your papers please, and stop you and demand to see your ID.
For the first time in history, the technology and the political will exist to fulfill prophecy.
The Real ID program, this was a part of a military appropriations bill.
Real ID sets federal guidelines for state driver's license that require international standards.
Buried and deep inside this huge legislation was a provision for essentially giving the federal government control over state driver's licenses.
The deadline's been extended most recently to January 2013.
You got the Titanic kind of coming along needing to realize that there's a lot more to it. We, I believe, the American people, indeed the people of the world, are in that same position. We've got a couple of little tiny glimmers that there's something wrong, that there are databases being collected, but what my research for the last 10 years has been about is trying to identify the bulk of that iceberg floating under the water so we don't hit it. As a Bible-believing Christian, I believe that this was foretold 2,000 years ago, that we're going to get to the point where every person on the globe will be issued a unique ID number. And they will have to have that unique ID number to participate in society.
Justification will exist to move the identification process from the ID documents to directly on the body.
They're placing right there at the cash register a device that is an RFID reader. Now, currently those devices are in place. You can take your contactless or your swipeless credit card and you simply hold it up to the reader device. But the technology in your RFID enhanced credit card, your contactless or swipeless credit card, is the same RFID technology that can be implanted into your right hand. And once those readers go into place at all the cash registers around the world, once people get used to this idea of just pressing the card up to the reader, it is just one step away from pressing your hand up to the reader. The real problem with the PASS Act or the Real ID or any other version of National ID is that the federal government has made it very clear that you will have to have this one single card in order to participate in pretty much any activity that people engage in modern life.
Citizens won't be able to engage in many routine activities.
You'll need it in order to get on an airplane. You'll need it in order to open a bank account. In many communities, you'll need it in order to buy a home or rent an apartment. And in fact, under the new nationalized ID healthcare system that we're moving towards, you'll actually be issued a unique ID number, and you won't even be able to go to a doctor without having this number. So I think we really are coming to the point that John, the Apostle John, talked about 2,000 years ago in exile in the Isle of Patmos off the coast of Greece when he actually had a vision and wrote it down in the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation.
Revelation 13, 16 through 18 is very straightforward. Biometric ID is an international ID applying to all. Biometric creates a direct link between one's body and control of financial transactions. And biometrics is a number of man.
And he causes all, he is the beast of the end time, he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark on their right hand or in their forehead. And that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. And then it tells us, here is wisdom, let him who has understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. This time that is described in the Bible that was foreseen 2,000 years ago made no sense for centuries and centuries. Now we are actually living in a time where we can envision how it would be possible to have a mark or a number in everyone's right hand or their forehead. And we are actually in a world where it is politically not only possible, but it's occurring before our very eyes, that you will have to have such a number issued by a government, potentially eventually a one-world government, in order to engage in any kind of commerce, to buy, to sell, to live your life.
I'm often asked, well, what is the New World Order? You know, what's the game plan? What's going on here? And let me put it this way. There is a small handful of very wealthy people, mostly men, that belong to what I call the secret societies.
But we're dealing, in fact, with a conspiracy here of power, and it's very secret. So they're not about to advertise who they are.
We're talking about the Council on Foreign Relations, its offshoot, the Trilateral Commission, and the internal nucleus of these groups, which meet once a year under the name Bilderbergers.
You might ask, what is the Bilderberg Group? It's actually one of multiple organizations that they have created in order to make sure that if discovered, if the conspiring nature of is discovered, they have multiple shoes to wear, they have multiple places to go, multiple organizations. For example, a lot of people think the Bilderberg Group is the conspiratorial organization because it's the most secretive. But in fact, they rarely ever make any decisions at Bilderberg. It's mere presentations. One year they met at the Aspen Institute, the top levels to decide what was going to be said at Bilderberg. Another year they met at the Council of Foreign Relations, just last year in London, a special tight-knit group of the hierarchy of the Council of Foreign Relations met to discuss what they were going to talk about at Bilderberg. Sometimes they used the Trilateral Commission.
I think it was all put down a book that was written in 1948 by a British Fabian socialist by the name of Eric Arthur Blair. Of course, he didn't use his name. He used the pen name George Orwell. And yes, that was the book 1984. So let's take a look at what that said. In 1984, the world has been divided into three major economic blocks. In the book, it was Oceania, Asiana, and East Asiana. Today's real world, we've got the European Union, the soon-to-be North American Union, which combines the economies of Canada, the United States, and Mexico, and then the future Asian Union.
I'm Joel Skousen, editor of World Affairs Brief, a weekly news analysis service. I'm a political scientist by training. I served in the military as a fighter pilot for the Marine Corps during the Vietnam era. I served as chairman of the Conservative National Committee in Washington, D.C. during the Reagan administration, as well as executive editor of Conservative Digest, commenting on what I believe are the critical pieces of information that are left out or omitted purposely from the news, the establishment news, that would drastically alter what people know and believe about what's going on in the nation.
I'm Jim Mars, and I'm a Texas journalist and author. I've had several New York Times best-selling books, and including Crossfire, The Plot to Kill Kennedy, which was a basis for Oliver Stone's film JFK.
In Munich, the security conference in February 2010, the National Security Advisor to President Barack Obama stated to the audience here, now this, I might remind you in context, was the day following a special honorary dinner they gave on behalf of Henry Kissinger, part of the European Union. So he gets up in his speech the next day and says, you know, I want to congratulate you for giving an award to Henry Kissinger. At the National Security Council, we take our daily marching orders from Henry Kissinger. It's an actual admission that Henry Kissinger, a non-elected official, has no power to dictate to anyone, is giving daily orders to the National Security Advisor of the United States of America. So,
folks, we're going to watch the last half of this next week. It's very, very good, as you can see. This is what I've been talking about for years on the radio. In fact, we're having a really big battle in Judd County with the Agenda 21 people right now. And this is Monday. They're going to have another meeting. They're going after Judge Grindel, and well, they're going after us, but, you know, we're pushing them back. In fact, they came to our last Tea Party meeting, and I made it very clear that if we had any problems, if you have questions you want to ask, or, you know, that's fine. But if you cause a problem, because they can get that way, okay, then you will be very quickly escorted out.
Wait, do you like the Orientals, do? Mm-hmm. Use a cane on them?
Well, anyhow. But they're the Agenda 21 people. And see, they're here, too. You have to understand. It'll hit you hard. And you know, you really need to be showing this in your church, too, Dave, or have your people here next week, because we're going to show the last part of this. It's very, very good. People need to understand, because they're coming. And I've seen, they've already made their projections. And where I live right now, they've got, by the year 2020, they've got it as a park. And my house is not there anymore. And they've already been doing that, working coupon, you know, cut the camera, okay? So